Good morning, everyone. Thank you for inviting me. Unfortunately, this year, all these recordings are not in person, which is kind of unfortunate. Hopefully, we get back to normal soon. I'm going to be talking the opposite side of the debate, that penumbral imaging in the late time window is not mandatory for EVT selection. These are my disclosures. I work with a bunch of device companies. I've got grants from many different companies for trials. As a starting point, acute ischemic stroke due to LVO, like this is the most amount of evidence that has been created, 7 published in NEJM. We put together the Hermes collaboration, published in Lancet and JAMA, where yet to find a subgroup where treatment does not work. Also, we know that for acute stroke, the only thing that works currently is opening the occluded vessel. Everything else is just steps along the way. Determining the size of penumbra does not improve patient outcome. Finding out whether the NIH is 17 or 19 does not improve patient outcome. Yes, certain steps along the way are necessary, clinical examination, imaging, but we have to minimize them and focus on opening the vessel. The brain is not the heart, as I like to say, never have respect for an organ that can be transplanted. This is the guy who did the first heart transplant and made the heart a disposable organ, but that will never, never happen for the brain. So the best that we can do is save neurons. We don't really understand brain eloquence. To give you an example, this person came in very early after stroke onset, 50 minutes, NIH 18-ish, 60-year-old. Imaging looks reasonable. And the patient had very poor collaterals on multiphase CTA, but the patient is youngish and see 50 minutes from onset. I don't really care what the imaging shows. I'm going to go open the vessel. There's a dissection in the neck. We go in there, get past the dissection, get into the intracranial circulation, deploy a stent retriever, and then pull the clot out. And we are still 95 minutes from onset. And as the following day, this is what the imaging looks like. A lot of white stuff on diffusion imaging, except the patient is nearly back to normal and walks out of the hospital. So there's this disconnect that we see between imaging and outcome. And that's something we need to recognize and be cognizant of, that we have this super, super powerful treatment. And should we be really be that dependent on imaging? And using this, I've been thinking about for many years now that, in my opinion, we recently published this review article in Stroke just 2 weeks ago, we should stop using the word core. And we sort of put together a worldwide group who are talking about it, partly because core is a depressing kind of term. And core makes it sound like, oh yeah, it's already dead tissue, while we don't know that it's dead tissue. And for the time being, till the time we understand it better, we have proposed this word SITUV, severely ischemic tissue of unknown viability. And why is it unknown? Partly because of constraints of imaging, but partly whether it will die or not will be decided by how fast and how well you open the vessel. This is an example from that paper where all this red stuff is there, but you open the vessel super fast, and then the red stuff is not dead on follow-up MR, not to mention the fact the patient improves as well. Another interesting part that we put together from the Hermes analysis, Merrill Bors from Amsterdam was the first author. You have all these patients who have big strokes and good outcome. You have all these patients who have small strokes but bad outcome. How is that happening? And this is not at baseline imaging where there's higher level of imprecision. This is at 24-hour imaging. And even more interesting was this paper in JAMA Neurology, again from Merrill Bors. So imagine you have a 50cc infarct, and this is the outcome. People who had control arm versus endovascular arm, endovascular people did better. How can we explain that? The only way we can explain that is that probably what is happening is selective tissue loss. And that is what we've talked about in this article. And that is something we need to be cognizant of, that even at 24 hours, our precision of imaging is quite low. So coming to the 24-hour trials or 6 to 24-hour trials, these were the two big trials, Dawn and Diffuse 3. When I saw the results, for me, the most interesting part was they were super, super selected patients. And in spite of that, in the control arm, 13% good outcome, and in the other one, 16% good outcome. That is, to my mind, very easy to beat. You don't need to have an effect size as massive as what was needed here. You don't need to have an NNT of 3. You need to be more inclusive in whom you select and give them the opportunity for treatment. And these patients are not eligible for TPA anyway. So either it's EVT or nothing at all. And we need to be more inclusive in the patients. And from the ESCAPE trial, which Dr. Schwab was very kind enough to participate in, and we did this trial together, and there were a lot of patients enrolled from Alberta. This is the late time window results from ESCAPE, where we had the same kind of effect size, same kind of outcomes, and did not have any complicated penumbral imaging criteria. CT multiphase CTA was used. This was put together called the Aurora, all the late time windows put together. We obviously contributed patients from Escape. This was presented, it's not published as yet, by Raul Noguera. These were all the selection criteria of all the late time window trials, including patients from Revascat Escape and obviously Dawn and Diffuse 3. And different trials did it differently. So it was summated all together, and there's 400 and something patients kind of thing. The baseline characteristics were all quite similar. The safety was quite similar, and in fact, quite similar to Hermes, even though this is late time window. But again, it's tough to find a subgroup where the treatment doesn't work. And if you look at aspects here, 0 to 7, 8 to 10, there is treatment effect, statistically significant treatment effect. If you go to further aspect 0 to 5, maybe it crosses the thing, but that is partly related to there were very few patients in there. But the bottom line is, this is based on plain and simple aspects in the late time window from the Aurora analysis. So essentially, coming back to decision making, you have three choices. You can take the patient to EVT with simple imaging, no EVT, or you can keep doing more imaging, CTP, MRI, look at color maps, look at this, look at that, measure volume, et cetera, et cetera. But at some point, you keep wasting time, and then the brain keeps dying, or you take the incorrect decision of not taking the patient to EVT because you were too conservative. And this applies to early and late time window. There is nothing magic about the six-hour window. It's just a random thing that played out that at the end, when Hermes and all was put together, a significant number of patients were in 0 to 6 hours, and some of the trials like Swift Prime, et cetera, enrolled patients only up to 6 hours. So this is sort of how it played out. Now, you've probably heard me speak about this idea of denominator fallacy, that how over-selection and analysis paralysis is actually harmful. So imagine that there are two cities, Gotham City and Metropolis. Imagine that they have similar population, similar demographics, and 200 patients with M1 occlusion come in. Batman, who's a simple kind of guy, is a practical guy. If I don't take the patient to EVT, there's no real option. Does CT, CT angiogram, takes 120 out of the 200 for EVT. These are all late-time window patients. 60 of them have a good outcome. So Batman writes a paper saying 50%, 60 out of 120 have a good outcome. Superman does complicated Dawn, Diffuse 3, talks about it, volume measurement, red map, green map, and then finally takes 20 patients for EVT, as there's 90% good outcome. And so, yeah, I'm really good. I have 90% good outcome. So essentially, then Superman tells Batman, I'm better than you. But the real truth is that in Gotham City, 30% of those patients have a good outcome, as opposed to only 9% in Metropolis. And remember, non-treated patients have really, really bad outcome, even in the super selected patients of Dawn and Diffuse 3. So this is just to get across the message that by over-selection, you're harming at a society level. Now, obviously, people talk about aspects that there's a problem, there's inter-observer variability, there's lack of precision. How can these be solved? First thing is, I travel around the world a lot, just do a high-quality CT head. And sometimes by doing maximum intensity projection on CT head, we are used to the term maximum intensity projection from MR, but not so much in CT. That can improve the gray-white differentiation. The second is correlation with collaterals. So essentially, if you're struggling to read aspects, the changes are not clear, go open the vessel. Or if you're struggling to read the aspects, go look at the collaterals. And the way to think about it is there a proximal clot? We don't like to use the word core, but is there extensive changes or non-contrast CT? And what do the collaterals look like? Will they keep the brain alive while you go open the vessel? And we think there's a trade-off of information versus speed, availability, and robustness. And you have to think about cost as well, contrast dosage, et cetera, et cetera. So you have to think in terms of speed, availability, and robustness, and information content. And obviously, MR should never, ever be done, in my opinion, for anterior circulation stroke. It's a complete waste of time. And actually, the CT angiogram is way higher quality than MR angiogram. From a CTP perspective, it's expensive, additional contrast, motion artifact. You have to use this complicated software. The red-green stuff is incorrect anyway. And therefore, we've stuck to this non-contrast CT, multiphase CTA. And the collaterals really help in determining your interpretation of non-contrast CT. In fact, at our institution, very often when new fellows come up, they call you in the middle of the night. They don't even look at the non-contrast CT or don't tell you on the phone, at least. They say, M1 occlusion, good collaterals. End of story, let's go open the vessel. So that's increasingly how it's working at our institution. So it's a reasonable tool in terms of speed, availability. You can do it on any scanner. You don't need additional software. It's got low radiation dose, low cost, no post-processing. And less deserving patients are excluded from treatment. And how do I know that? Here's some evidence for it. So firstly, the evidence for MCT, it was used in Escape, Escape NA1, and both of these patients were enrolled up to 12 hours. This was the original paper in radiology. From an escape-NA1 perspective, the patient that would be on 6 hours, I'm going to show you the result. But before that, just to show you, we did this detailed analysis, which is currently under review, that we were able to show that multi-phase CTA-based selection is way more inclusive than CT perfusion-based selection. Not only that, the multi-phase CTA-based selection that were CTP ineligible still did really good after EVT. And that is important to remember, that we took these patients who were CTP ineligible, MCTA eligible in a multicentric study, and took them for EVT, and the outcomes were pretty good. This is currently under review. And then this is the detailed analysis of the late time window patients from ESCAPE-NA1. As you know, ESCAPE-NA1 is published in Lancet. So we compared it to DAWN and DIFFUSE-3. So firstly, the door to groin was much shorter in ESCAPE-NA1 than DAWN DIFFUSE-3. Probably some of it is related to not having complicated imaging. Imaging to groin was again shorter. And then TICI-2V3 was very similar in all the three trials. And then in terms of infarct volume at 24 hours, DAWN had the lowest infarct volume, DIFFUSE-3 had higher, and in fact, ESCAPE-NA1. But mind you, though, there is not standardization of the measurement of infarct volume. But here's the interesting part, the MRS at 90 days. So it doesn't matter, you look at ESCAPE-NA1, DAWN, or DIFFUSE-3, they were all identical, in spite of having easy selection criteria and not making it complicated. And we know that we were more inclusive, and we know that our speed was better than DAWN and DIFFUSE-3. So this is a really important thing to keep in mind. So the bottom line is, be smart and be fast. Avoid analysis paralysis. You do not need fancy color maps. And the important thing to remember is, as you go through the details of thinking about it, those color maps are probably incorrect anyway. We should not be using the word core. We should acknowledge our limitations. We should acknowledge also the fact that as we go forward, the technique of EVT continues to improve. Yes, I'm a big fan of evidence-based medicine. Yes, I'm a big fan of the idea of randomized trials, but not when the NNT was 3, which is completely a bad way of looking at things, and we're leaving a lot of patients if we don't treat them. Secondly, there are no other options. These patients will not get tPA. And I'm showing you all this additional evidence, the late time window patients from AURORA, from ESCAPE-NA1, and from ESCAPE. Obviously, you've heard the results of ESCAPE-NA1 in the no tPA time window, and we are going to be repeating that. The trial is called ESCAPE Next. We'll be starting that soon. And it's quite possible, let's see how the story plays out, but 2 years from now, it may change. Also, neuroprotection may change how we think about this problem. Thank you very much.